Daniel chapter 9, verses 24 through 27. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city, to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to the restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the Prince, shall be 7 weeks, and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troubled times. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself, and the people of the Prince shall come, shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. And the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end war desolations are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week, and in the midst of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of abominations he shall make it desolate, even unto the consummation, and that determined shall be poured out upon the desolate.
I just want to go ahead and explain this at the very beginning so you know what this is. I gave this as a handout in the back, and if you need one, you can get one before you leave. That'll be great. This side, most people are familiar with, because as we went through the book of Revelation, and we used this as a timeline. So I thought, hey, this might be a good idea to put the timeline on one side. And then when you flip it, you have Daniel chapter 9, verse 24 through 27, and the timeline for that. The reason I'm saying that is this. What we're getting ready to go over today, and Lord willing, next week, is the cornerstone of all Bible prophecy. I will let that just soak in for just a minute. If you don't get Daniel 9, 24 through 27 right, none of the other stuff will make sense. Okay? So that's I just want you to understand that. That's why I put it in this form, so that you'd have it. Don't be afraid. Don't look at it and say, oh man, I will never figure that out. When we get done with this, you'll be able to figure this out. And guess what? You'll be able to take your Bible, go to any Cracker Barrel, Bob Evans, and a whoever, Waffle House, wherever you want to go, McDonald's, wherever you want to go, Starbucks, wherever you want to go. I didn't get them all in there, but all of them. You can go anywhere you want to go, and you can pull this out of your Bible, and you can go through and study what God's Word says about the end times with folks. Because why? Because we're living in the end times. Amen? We really are. And if you're not familiar with that, you ought to be familiar with that, because it's obvious that we're living in the end times. If you've missed that, you've missed everything going on for the last 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 years of what's going on. And I'm not here to tell you that the Lord's coming back on this day. And if you hear anybody say that, just about face and run. You say, really? Really. Just run. Because why? They're not reading God's Word. How do I know that? Because watch this. This will be one to grapple with. The very Son of God says that he doesn't even know. So whenever you're going to sit down and you're going to tell me, Pastor, I know the date, I'm going to look at you and I'm going to say, number one, you're not the Son of God. And number two, he doesn't even know. So why would it make that you would know? So don't be date setting or anything like that. Don't say, all you can know is what? You know that the seasons of the times, it's ripe. It's ripe. Because why? Because we're living in the apostate age. The apostate age, the Laodicean age. Right here it says church age. Right underneath there it says Revelation 2 and 3. Okay? And so you will know this as you go through there and you look and see what stage, where are we at? What age are we in? And should you know what the times are? Yes, you ought to be familiar with the times. You ought to be familiar with what's going on and say, well, you know, it's pretty obvious. Because why? Because people are walking away from the church. People are walking away. Now watch this. And I didn't say the church building. People are walking away from the teaching of God's Word in the church. Now, if we would have done just what we just did right there for 45 more minutes, and I would have said what I just said now and said bye, people would go, man, that's the greatest church in the world. Because why? Because they really didn't get into the Word. The Word is the focus. It's not me. It's not anyone else. It's the very Word of God that's a focus. And so I just want to get you in the context of what we're doing today so that you understand, hey, that's serious stuff that we're going to get into today. Because it really is. Oh, by the way, all of God's Word is serious stuff. It's not to be left out. It doesn't make a difference how much history you know. It's how much do you know about Him. Because it's His story. And if you know Him, then that's awesome. If you don't know Him, you need to know Him. Because there's no absolute hope for anyone without Him. So we come to Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9 revolves around two focal points. It's in fact, first Daniel believed in old prophecy. And we went over this in earlier times. He believed an old prophecy, and then he received a new prophecy. That's Daniel chapter 9 at the beginning and Daniel chapter 9 at the end. And between that is Daniel's prayer. And we went over that, and we looked at what that looked like, and we ought to be people that are praying just like Daniel. So it's very important. But we come to the last part, the very last verses in chapter 9, verses 24 through 27. And we look today at what's called the 70 weeks. The 70 weeks, you might have heard it called the 70 weeks of Daniel. And so what are the 70 weeks? The 70 years foretold by Jeremiah was foretold in Jeremiah 25, 11, and 12, and Jeremiah 29, verse 10. You read these words, and God's word says, he says, "And this whole land shall be a desolation and astonishment, and these nations shall serve the king Babylon 70 years. And it shall come to pass when 70 years are accomplished that I will punish the king of Babylon and that nation, saith the Lord, for their iniquity and the land of the Chaldeans, and will make it perpetual desolations." That's Jeremiah 25, 11, and 12. But then also you see in Jeremiah 29, 10, "For thus saith the Lord, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word toward you in causing you to return to this place." So Daniel had the scroll there of Jeremiah, and he's reading what Jeremiah had written. And he was studying the word of God, what he had in his hands. And so he had this foretold, the 70 years were foretold by Jeremiah, had all but expired. Because why? Daniel's sitting there and going, "Hey, you know, it's been almost 70 years I've been here. 70 years that I've been here in Babylon and that I've been in the government of Babylon, and here I am." And so today, far from the end of the exile being the preliminary step to the setting up of the Messianic kingdom, a further 77s of years had been determined. And we said last time that when he prayed, God said, "Hey, Gabriel, I want you to go down and I want you to tell Daniel the rest of the story, so that he understands." And so just as a review, we need to understand how we got to Daniel chapter 9, verse 24. How do you get there? Remember that to keep the old covenant, and they were no longer, the Lord called for Babylon to do his bidding when it comes to the punishment that was given, and he was doing his bidding in judging Israel. They were under judgment for falling and failing to keep the old covenant, and they were no longer under God's protection. But on Daniel, as Daniel explained to King Nebuchadnezzar, the Lord had sentenced Israel to remain under Gentile oppression for quite some time. And the Babylonians would be merely the first of multiple Gentile kingdoms to capture the city as well as the temple. And the Lord would no longer defend Israel as he once did under David and Solomon. Instead, the Lord said he would send wave after wave of Gentiles against his people. And most of you are staring at that and you remember that. That's Daniel chapter 2 and that's Daniel chapter 7. And you see that Daniel chapter 2 is from the viewpoint of the vision that was given to King Nebuchadnezzar. Daniel chapter 7, as you see here, is the vision that was actually given to Daniel himself. And those visions mirrored one another. What do you mean, Pastor? What I mean by this, this is time. From here going down is time. Okay, that's time. Start down to the finish. Head down to the toe. What happened? You have the Golden Age, the Babylonian the Great. This is an exile. It's 605 BC that they were taken off. Daniel and his friends, the super crust of the Jewish people, were taken off, and they were taken in exile to Babylon. That's the first of the four kingdoms that would come. It's the Golden Age, Babylon the Great. Daniel and Daniel 7 saw it as the lion. But this is what Nebuchadnezzar saw. Okay, the second one to come is the Silver Age. That is the Medo-Persian Empire. And Daniel saw that as the bear. You remember the bear with the three ribs that was in the bear's mouth in Daniel chapter 7. Then you have the next one is the Greek Empire. And that was the leopard. The leopard being very fast, had four wings. Remember that? In Daniel chapter 7. Okay, Daniel chapter 2, what was it? Well, it was this right here, this area, the Golden Gate, the area right here of the Bronze Age. All right, and then lastly is the Roman Empire. It's called the beast by Daniel in his dream. Okay, and that's from the legs on down. The legs on down being 2, 1 and 2, and then you have the 10 toes at the very end. All right? That will be the modern age, the new revived beast, who you will see, and we will talk about him in verse 26 and 27. He is the prince to come, and he is the Antichrist. There'll be 10 kings that'll be set up. And this is after the rapture has occurred. He will have 10 kings that'll be set up, and the rapture will occur, and the Antichrist will take over. You remember at the very beginning, Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, he'll make a covenant. I like that. It's done. At the end, he'll make a covenant. And the covenant will say for 7 years, that covenant will be made. And he'll say to them at the very beginning, you can worship who you want to worship. I don't care who you worship. But then in the middle of that, as you see on the bottom of the page, in the middle of that, he will change. And what will he do? He will take his image, the Antichrist image, and he will put that in the temple. And they will worship, and everyone will worship him and him alone. And that last 3.5 years is known as the Great Tribulation. Okay? So all of these things are coming to pass, and this is how we got there in Daniel chapter 9. He's seen these visions. He's explained these visions. Now he needs more detail of what's going on. In fact, in Daniel chapter 8, verse 27, Daniel foresaw this future for his people, and it left him astounded. It left him exhausted. It left him speechless, and he was even sick, because what does he say? And I, Daniel, fainted and was sick certain days. Afterward, I rose up and did the king's business, and I was astonished at the vision. But none understood it. None understood it. Nevertheless, Daniel's visions did not foretell the destruction of the Jewish people. On the contrary, his visions of the age of the Gentiles always ended with the promised one returning to save Israel. It always ended with that. But something's wrong, because why? Remember, the time of the Gentiles, the age of the Gentiles, is given to us by the Lord Jesus Christ. Where's that found? Luke chapter 21, verse 24 and following. I'm doing this as review so you'll understand where we're going to go, so that you know what's going on. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led away captive into all nations. Who's they? Jewish people. Okay, understand that there is the distinct difference between Jewish people and Christian people when it comes to eschatology, end times prophecy. There's a difference. We are not taking over Israel's place. Don't you dare say that. You'll offend somebody that's here, and that somebody's sitting in the back row. That person that's here today received Christ as his Savior, and he was born a Jew. And he's a born-again Jew. He said amen right then. So be careful the way you look at prophecy, and you understand there is a distinct difference. Because why? Because whatever God says in the very beginning, he doesn't change his mind no matter what goes on. Because why? Because he's God and no one else is. And he promised back in Genesis chapter 12 that I will give you a land. And the Jewish people will have their land. Have they gotten it yet? They haven't gotten it yet, but it's coming. They did have it if they would have went in. She's partially correct. Because he said what? I want you to go in, and I want you to drive everything out. And what'd they do? Were they obedient or disobedient? How about you? You obedient or disobedient for everything he tells you? So it ought to be a learning experience to say, hey, you know what? You don't get away with your sin. It said this in the Bible, be sure your sin will find you out. It doesn't make a difference you're Jewish. It doesn't mean you're Gentile. It doesn't matter who you are. It will find you out. So what do you have to do with that? Well, the great thing you do is just what? Confess your mess. And when you confess your mess, he says what? I have and will forgive you, because why? I sent my only begotten son to take your place. and to pay for the sin that you have committed. And you are free and clear if you receive the gift that I give you, and that gift is Jesus Christ and his shed blood upon the cross of Calvary. And that's what we have sang about this morning. And that's why we come together to celebrate, to say, praise the Lord. God has not left us alone. He's not left us to die in our sins. He's given us a gift. And if we will receive the gift, then we go to be with him forever. That's a wonderful thing. And if you've never received that gift, you say, well, what do I have to do to receive that gift? Just like every human being has always received the gift, you admit that you're a sinner, ask Christ to come into your life and save you, and he comes in and saves you. You say, it can't be that easy. No, that's what the devil tells you. That's way too easy. But what God says is this: believe me or believe you. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof is the ways of death. Twice that's said in Proverbs. Don't forget it. What God says will come to pass, and everything that he has ever said and ever promised will come literally to pass. He won't miss a thing. Because why? He is a good, gracious God. And I love him with all of my heart. And he will not lie to you, because why? It's his very nature. He cannot lie to you, because that's not who he is. So you can believe exactly what he has said. And as we go through the book of Daniel, and time and time and time and time and time again, everything comes to pass exactly like he said. When he said it would occur, it all come to pass. And so as we read through the book of Daniel, it is actually confirmation that God is who he said he is. And you can believe him in every aspect of every part of life. When he talks to you about what's going on, he's not lying. God is good. I got to quit. I'm going to preach. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive in all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times. The word times is also the word age. They're synonyms. You can say times or you can say age. Doesn't make a difference in our vernacular, in our English. The same words, until the times or the age of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And there shall be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars upon the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. For the powers of heaven shall be shaken, and then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up, lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. He promises. Jesus Christ announced it, put it in writing, and he announces it so that you will know. He said, these things will happen. So Daniel is sitting there at the end of this age of Gentile rule. The Messiah will return to establish a new kingdom. You remember we had a picture for that. What did that picture look like? It looks like this picture. Remember? This is the image. This is the age of the Gentiles. This is the whole thing. At the end, he's going to come. This is Jesus Christ going to come. This is just a pictorial version of that that somebody's put together. And where does he hit? He hits the feet, because why? That's at the end of the time. He didn't hit the head, didn't hit the heart. He hits what? The feet. Because that's the end of the time, and he will crush. And when you hit the feet, what else happens? Everything else comes crumbling down. What's that mean? That is the end of the times of the Gentiles. That's the end of the age of the Gentiles. What do you mean that age of the Gentiles? If you will, Mark, go back to Luke chapter 21 there. Luke chapter 21, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive in all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles. Those things occurred very first time in 605 BC. When they were carted off to Babylon. It was the first time that every one of these was completed. It was known that they fell by the edge of the sword. They were led away captives into Babylon, which is the height of pagan religion. And then Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles. Tell me, have they always been trodden down since that time? The answer starts with a Y, it ends with an S. Yes. You go there today. They're coming back by the droves. But who's in control? They aren't in control of all of it. Because why? Because they can't go to their temple and worship. Because why? Who has the temple? One word. Gentiles do. Because why? Because he said it would happen. And it's the age of the Gentiles. That age is going to come to an end. But we have a 7-year tribulation that's got to occur. We have a rapture of the church, the bride, that has to occur. We have a few things that have to occur before then. And every one of them will occur literally. Cause why? Because he said they would. I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful that what? That he tells you the truth and he tells me the truth. So don't ever say that the Lord, for some reason, is tiptoeing up and going to boom, scare you. Because that's not true. Since the book of Daniel, he's been telling us this is going to occur. He has laid everything out so that what? So that you could know that these things are going to come to pass. The question is, and the only question that's important for you as you sit here today, it's not about prophecy. The question is, where are you going to be when you take your last breath? Where are you going to go? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8 says, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. If what? If you're in the family of God. If you're not in the family of God, Luke 16 says that you'll split hell wide open. And just like the rich man in hell, you'll lift up your eyes being in torments. You say, well, that's just, that's a picture. That's not real. Everything that he talks about is real. And all of the pictures point to a reality. Separation in hell, where there's going to be torment, and you will watch this, you will get your way when it comes to hell. What do you mean? For those that are here this morning and say, God, I don't want you, and I don't care what you do, and I don't care who you think you are, I want to do my own thing. Leave me alone. Kids are going to go to the wilds. They're saying they have the wilds. Two choices on the shelf, pleasing God or pleasing self. I'll say that again. There's two choices on the shelf, pleasing God or pleasing self. You going to please you? Or are you going to please God? C.S. Lewis said it this way, I think. He said, either not my will but thine be done, God, or God's going to say, not my will but thine be done. And Romans chapter 1 at the very end says he gives them over to a reprobate mind. That you would what? That you would get your way. So if you're here this morning and you don't know Christ as your Savior and you say, hey, I'm going to do my own thing, I implore you and I beg you with all seriousness to evaluate where you're at and make sure that you're found in the family of God. Every Christian that's here and every Christian that will be and that has been, every single one of us have come to know Christ exactly the same way, different circumstances, but exactly the same way. For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourselves, the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And so the things that we're talking about, the things that are going to come, you don't have to experience many of those. But he's telling you, God has been so gracious to tell us, this is what's going to happen. This is what's going to happen. So at the end of this age of Gentile rule, the Messiah will return to establish a new kingdom to replace all Gentile authorities. And in that day, Israel receives the promises that God gave to Abraham, that he gave to Isaac, and that he gave to Jacob. So Daniel's prophecies, they are bittersweet. In fact, they represent and present a troubling warning of dark times to come for Israel. And yet, the dark period eventually ends with Israel in glory. But up to this point in Daniel's visions, the Lord has given no indication of exactly how long this age will last. So given the happy ending, it's only natural that Daniel would be hoping for the end to come quickly. I know I would. For unfortunately for Daniel, the age of the Gentiles isn't a short-lived period of history. It will run a long time, certainly longer than Daniel's lifetime. And furthermore, the age proceeds through various stages, and it overlaps prophetic events that God has revealed for Israel. The people of Israel will go in and they'll go out of various situations, including bondage, including exile, regathering back together, and exile again. And we've seen this in the history of Israel. Specifically, the Lord told Israel through another prophet, Jeremiah, that Judah would be held in captivity during the early years of this age. But then at a point, Israel will be permitted to return to Jerusalem. Isn't that exactly what we read? After Daniel's time, what'd they do? They allowed him to go back. Did Daniel go back? No, they didn't. I had somebody that's digging deep into God's Word ask me and texted me this week, well, what happened? Everybody else went back. Why didn't Daniel go back? To tell you the truth, I don't know. But I do know this. Daniel was 85 plus years old. To make that trip's a long ways. Also, Daniel still had a position within the government. And so I believe that that's two things that possibly he didn't go back. He was doing the work that he was called to do, and he was going to die right where he was. And he gave us exactly what God had told him to write. He gave us everything that we need to know. And so, from the last time, God has sent Gabriel to what? To give skill and understanding. Chapter 9, verse 22. You see, Gabriel came. God said, I want you, Gabriel, to go, and I want you to inform him and give him skill and understanding that he knows what's going on. And now we're given the information concerning the 70 weeks. See, man, that's a long introduction. Don't worry, we're not going to be here much longer. Number one, I'm going to give you this. Number one, the 70 weeks are decreed. The 70 weeks are decreed. Gabriel made the abrupt announcement. So what did he say? Look at it. Look at verse 24. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to what? To finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. That's a whole lot right there. So let's go through this. The word determine signifies cut off. That is divided from all of the years, from the period of the times of the Gentiles, which we just talked about, the time when world power is in Gentile hands. That word weeks is literally sevens. So we could say the 70 weeks, we could say the 77s. Okay, the sevens. That's literally what it means. And sevens of years are undoubtedly intended. It's not months, it's not days, it's not weeks, it's years. Daniel had been thinking of the 70 years of Jeremiah's prophecy. You see that in Daniel chapter 9, verse 2. And you see that also in Jeremiah 25, verse 11. He's been reading this. And so he sees this. The idea of sabbatical years made the idea of a seven of years familiar to Jews. It's not familiar to us. One thing that is familiar is we would say this. We say the word dozens. Dozens always means 12. A dozen of what? Eggs, first thing comes to mind, dozen of eggs. Do you say a dozen of tires? What do you normally say? and you buy 12 tires. Let's say this, give me a dozen of batteries. No, you usually say, I want 12 batteries. It's specific, you want that. Well, this is their vernacular. This is the same way that we say the word dozens, okay? So this is not a stretch. I just want to give you an idea of this is what he's saying, and this is where this is at. This is very well known. So as a Jewish person, am I correct? You would know this. This is not totally foreign to you. You would know this, okay? We wouldn't, because why? We don't do that with that word. But this is what's known here. It's 70 weeks. All right, I mean years. I'm sorry, here we go. 70 weeks is 70 years. All right, and so first of all, the idea of sabbatical years made the idea of a seven of years familiar to Jews. So first of all, we see the focus of the period. The focus of the period is significant, because what's the focus on? The focus is on who? The focus is on the Israelites. The 70 weeks focuses on the Israelites. Okay, so watch this, verse 24. The reference here is Daniel's people, the Jews, and to the what? The holy city, Jerusalem. This prophecy has nothing to do with the church. Because why? Because nobody in the Old Testament even knew about that coming. Okay, it has everything to do with the Jews. Nor does the prophecy have primary reference to the world in general. In other words, the entire course of the 77s, 70 times 7 is what? 490 years. Okay, I know a little math here. Some of you don't like math. Okay, 70 times 7 is 490 years. It has to do with the Jewish people and their own country. So then this period of 490 years was to be marked from whatever protracted length of time was involved in what? In the times of the Gentiles. During this 490-year period, God would have special dealings with the Jews while they were in their own land. And this is quite apart from any disciplinary dealings with the Jews while they were dispersed in Gentile lands. So the focus of this period is obviously on God and the Jewish people. Secondly, you see the features of the period. The features of the period. What's he say? Well, in verse 24, we have certain things were to be accomplished. First of all, God will cancel all sin. Does he say that? Yes, he says that. He says that in verse 24. To finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for iniquity. There's three words there. Three different words that are used there. Daniel had been using some of these same words. The three words that Gabriel used summarizes human sin. In fact, the word for transgression has to do with revolt or rebellion. Transgression, revolt or rebellion. It is a sin against lawful authority. Some of you know what that's like. Maybe this week, maybe this month, you got a speeding ticket. That's lawful authority. What'd you do? You rebelled. And your car just rebelled against what that said. And so you received a ticket. Well, that's what's called the defiance of sin. The defiance of sin. So that's what he's talking about to finish the transgression. Transgression summarizes the general history of the nation of Israel. I mean, almost from the very start, their murmurings against Moses in the wilderness, the rebellion of Korah against the authority of Moses and Aaron, the people's rebellion at Kadesh Barnea against going into Canaan. Both Israel's and Judah's history under the kings was so rebellious that what? That both kingdoms had to be deported under the sharp displeasure of God. So this is very well known in history. And so they knew that. However, notice there's a word there that gets you. It's the word the. The word transgression is singular or plural? Singular, thank you. Great. Singular. Watch this, okay? To finish the transgression. This particular event focuses on the sin of Israel, and specifically the rejection of the Messiah. Watch this, as the nation of Israel rejected her Messiah. You remember? You have the day when he comes in and they put down the palm branches, and it's called what Sunday? Palm Sunday, which happens before, which is also the crucifixion. So Palm Sunday, they say, "Blessed be the name of the Lord," from Psalm 118. And they lay the palms down. And what are they saying? They're literally saying, "You are the Son of God." But what happens 1 week later? "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate says, "What do you want me to do?" "Crucify him! He is not our Savior." They committed, watch this, the unforgivable sin. You see, I've heard about that word. They, in that time period, in that event in history, they committed the unforgivable sin by saying no to the Spirit of God speaking to their hearts and saying, "We do not believe that you are him. Therefore, crucify him." Someone ever comes, just by the way, someone ever comes to me and says, "Do you think that I have ever committed the unforgivable sin?" This is what you can say to the individual that comes and asks you. "The fact that you are asking me says no. The very fact that you're asking." Because anybody who has done that, I don't want him no matter what. So I just encourage you, don't say no to God. And don't give a lame excuse why you ought to say no to him, because no excuse that you will ever give holds water. Ask Daniel, who left home when he was a teen and never had anybody else around to stroke him on the back and to say, "Hey, keep studying God's word, keep studying God's word, keep studying God's word." Daniel knew what it was to have a relationship with Almighty God. I love Daniel. He's somebody that you can pattern your life after, because he loved God no matter what. First of all, you have the defiance of sin. Now look at the next word. The next one is to make an end of sins. That's plural, and its meaning is this: missing the mark. Missing the mark. It brings to mind the deficiency of sin. The nation of Israel came tragically short of the glory of God. And God had chosen a nation, set apart his people to be a testimony to him. And the living God had taken up residence among his people, enthroned in the temple of Jerusalem. And God intended that all nations might come to know him through the godly testimony of the Hebrew people. The nation, however, they missed the mark. They missed it. The third word here is iniquity. He goes on and he says, and to make reconciliation for iniquity. We also have seen this, Daniel's confession. It signifies crookedness and bentness of human nature. It suggests the distortion of sin. God's people had distorted the image of God. And many of them had agreed, what, to idolatrous practices. And then, when they returned from Babylon, they became proud and disdainful of all of the Gentiles. Arrogant in their exclusiveness, hypocritical in their Phariseeism, and blind leaders of the blind in their rabbinical traditions. It is significant that before the blessing comes to Israel, the sin must be removed. This fact is emphasized three times to show the great importance of removing sin before the blessing comes. Daniel had been praying for the forgiveness of their sin, and here God promises the removal and hence the forgiveness of their sin. We need to put the priority on purity if we want to do a work for God. What do I mean by that? Today, we seem to prefer toleration of sin rather than removal of sin. We just tolerate it. After all, we've got to be inclusive. We don't want to draw a line. Wait a minute. Can't do that. No, friend, you don't have to do that. God has already done that. And that's very unpopular in our culture today. Very unpopular. But what we always say, there's only one opinion that makes any difference. It's God's. And every one of us will stand before Him and give an account of His opinion versus anyone else's. God's great work is the removing of sin. Sin is the cause of all problems. In fact, Adam and Eve lived in a perfect environment. They had a perfect situation. They had a perfect teacher. They had a perfect God. But sin ruined it, and Israel had ruined their situation by sin, and God will restore Israel, but not before sin is removed. God intends to do more than just cancel sin. Secondly, He says what? He will complete our salvation. He'll complete it. That's a wonderful thought. He's going to complete it. What's it say? To bring in everlasting righteousness. When sin is removed, righteousness is to replace sin. And note, it is everlasting righteousness, which reminds us of the eternality of salvation. Once we are saved, we're saved forever and will for all eternity have the righteousness of God. That is indeed everlasting righteousness. There will be no more sin. It's also a clear reference to what? To His kingdom. And this agrees with Daniel chapter 2. It agrees with Daniel chapter 7, where we are learned that the end of the age leads to the arrival of the kingdom. And this result has already been effected where? At the cross. And is being made good in the lives of believers today. The emphasis here, however, is on the nation of Israel. As far as the nation of Israel is concerned, fulfillment of this divine goal awaits the national conversion of the Jewish people to Christ at His second coming. Then the Jews as a nation will come into the good of the new covenant. The new covenant is found in Jeremiah 31, verses 33 through 40. Today, individual Jews who accept Christ come into the good of those clauses immediately. But as a nation, the Jews remain adamant in unbelief. Now, I know there's the question. This is the question. If you're thinking at all, you're asking the question, same question I asked. Even though God has distinct plans for Israel and the church, what happens if a Jew becomes a Christian in the current church age? And that's a great question. The answer is simple. God still has plans for national Israel. But if an individual Jew places faith in Christ during the current church age, that Jewish person is absorbed into the body of Christ, thereby becoming a part of the church. Amen. Absolutely wonderful. You talk about a great thing to be a Jew and to be a Christian. That's a double blessing. Galatians chapter 3, verse 28, so you don't think I'm jumping off the rails here. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There's neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. All one in Christ Jesus. Just because an individual Jew might become a Christian and a member of the church does not in any way negate God's broader promises to national Israel. God will fulfill all he has promised to Israel. Number three, God will confirm the scriptures. He says he will. To seal up the vision and prophecy. All that the prophets have foretold of both comings of Christ will be fulfilled in the letter. Not even the most obscure prophetic scripture will be overlooked. History will put its seal on the entire prophetic age. And when the 70 weeks are over, Israel's prophecy will be completed. It'll be finished. All of this reminds us that God's word is true. And by the way, he told us it would be. Isaiah 55, verse 11, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. If God said that it would happen, it will indeed happen. Woe to those who mock the word of God and scorn its predictions. They will spend, sadly, an eternity in hell, away from God, away from truth. Finally, number four, God will consecrate the sanctuary. He will consecrate the sanctuary. Some of you just get a little mad because you see there in Israel and you get mad that that dome over there is not theirs. Just settle down. It's okay. We haven't gotten to the end yet. And man, it's cool. The end's really cool. Because what he said is going to come to pass. It really is. The most holy is the holy of holies. You see, when the tabernacle that Moses built was finished, it was anointed. And no such anointing is spoken of in connection with either Solomon's temple or Zerubbabel's temple. They are viewed as an extension of the tabernacle. But now that the Lord's sacrifice for sins has been made at Calvary, when Ezekiel's temple is built as the center of worship during the millennium, the Holy of Holies will be anointed as Gabriel proclaimed that it would. The climax of God's program for the Jew and of all the world history will be the reigning of Jesus Christ over the entire world. And this will come about at the end of the 70 weeks. For when the 70 weeks end, Christ will be made king of all. And then the Jews will accept him. They'll bow before him as we will enter the entire world will together be worshiping him. All of these features are millennial in focus. See, really, is there a millennium? I didn't say that. God did. Because he says it, I believe it. If you want to argue with him, go right ahead. But he said there would be a literal 1,000 years. And that's on his program. The close of the 70 weeks will coincide with the end of the times of the Gentiles and with the inauguration of the millennial reign of Christ. Thus, the 70 weeks were decreed. Their end is not Calvary. Their end is literally the second coming of Jesus Christ, which will occur at the end of the 7 years of tribulation. So I hope that you're putting those pieces together in your mind, and we have it here for you pictorially so that you don't get confused. We now learn that the 70 weeks are divided. And this is where I'm going to stop. The 70 weeks are divided. I just want to show you something real quick so you can chew on this week, all right? God has made a threefold division of these weeks. What are they? Division number one, 7 weeks. You remember the word for weeks is sevens. Seven sevens, 7 times 7, 49 years. Then there's 3 score, which is 20, by the way. If you get King James Version, a score is 20. So 3 times 20, 60. Plus 2 is 62 weeks. 62 times 7, that's literally what weeks is, 7, equals 434 years. 443 years and 49 years is 483 years. Seeing something here? 490 minus 483 equals 7. So you have 1 week left, he says. That'll be 7 years, making a total of 490 years. It's exactly what he's been telling us the whole time. To the T, he's telling us that. So don't go away saying, man, I have no idea what God's doing. You have every idea what God's doing. Why? Because he told you what he's going to do. So many people say, boy, if I knew that was coming, I'd be ready. You come to somebody's house, you knock on the door, and you say, well, I had no idea you're coming. We don't have anything ready. We got everything all out of place. We're not ready for you to come. But if I call you and say, hey, by the way, I'm coming, and this is, I'm going to be coming. I want you to know I'm going to be coming. Don't be surprised when I come. I'm coming. So you couldn't just say, well, man, I had no idea you were coming. Well, I called you 4 months ago. I said I'd be coming sometime. You say, you know what? You're exactly right. That's crazy of me not to be ready when you come. There's so many pictures in that. But I hope that you're ready for him to come. I hope that your words can be the same that said in the Bible, even so, Lord, come quickly. Even so, Lord, come quickly. We're ready for you to come. I hope you're ready for that. I'm going to do this real quick. On this side, right here, as you have your paper, that is the book of Revelation and the timeline for the book of Revelation. Okay, on your sheet. So you have that. This is the cross. This is Pentecost. Christ rose from the dead. This is the church age that's going on here. Pentecost to rapture. Church age. At the end of this, the rapture is going to occur, the rapture of the church. Then shortly after, there will be 7 years of tribulation. 3.5 years, you have the seven sealed judgments, you have two witnesses that preach, 145,000 Jewish evangelists that will preach the gospel all over the world. In the middle of this three and a half, right in the middle, the Antichrist will do exactly what I said earlier. He said, you're done worshiping who you want to. Now you're going to worship me. Because why? In Isaiah chapter 14, 5 times he says, I will, I will, I will, I will, I will. He said, I will be like God. And God reminded him, you won't. But he's going to try. And so they'll worship at 3.5 years. You have the 7 trumpet judgments. You have the 7 vial bowl judgments. You have kings join Antichrist. Then you have the battle of Armageddon. We talked about that. That's a campaign. More than one battle. The Battle of Armageddon. At the end of this tribulation period, you have the second coming of Christ, which is the revelation. That's why the arrow is coming down, because why? Because his bride, the church, and he himself, the King of Kings, is coming down to the earth to put his feet on the earth. The rapture has an arrow going up, because why? The rapture is us meeting Jesus Christ in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And so the tribulation period deals mainly with the Jewish people here on earth. At the end of that second coming, the revelation of Christ comes down. We come with him. We rule and reign for 1,000 years. That's called the millennium. Who starts the millennium? Everybody will be saved that starts the millennium. Who ends the millennium? A lot of people. Because why? They'll take, I have to say this because of the culture we live in, they will take literally, be fruitful and multiply. And it won't be the same sex, it'll be two different opposite sex, just like God said, and they will have kids. And they'll have a whole lot of them. By the way, something for you to think about. If you don't have a man and a woman, you don't have society. A homosexual agenda produces no culture at all, except a prideful, selfish culture. And it's against what God says. And I love you if you're here and you're of that culture. I love you. But I want you to know, just like the person you may be sitting beside, they just may be a liar. It's all right. We're all guilty of sin. And we're all in need of a Savior. And Christ died specifically for all sinners. No matter what flavor of sin you are, Christ dies for all of them. That's great news. At the end of the thousand-year millennial reign, who's let loose for a season? Satan's let loose for a season to what? To gather all together those who are non-believers. You say, are you serious? There's going to be non-believers at the end of the millennial time? There'll be a whole lot of them. Because why? Because they were born as sinners at the very beginning by people who had received Christ as their Savior, but their bodies hadn't been changed. They also have the sin nature, and they passed it right along just like we have the sin nature. So they either have to receive or reject Jesus Christ. And by the way, Jesus Christ is ruling and reigning from Jerusalem. So that occurs in the great white throne. Who goes up here? All those that are lost go to the great white throne judgment. And they will give an account for their what? Works. Two religions. Done by Jesus Christ or I work. And if you work, you will never work enough to pay it all off. And that's what's going to happen. So what? What did he say? Not my will, but yours be done. You asked to work for it, so here you go. This is what your work gets you. It's an eternal separation from me. God says, why? Because that's what you've asked for. So it's an eternal separation from me forever. God is a total gentleman. He always has been. He's totally good. And then you have eternity. So that's one side, and the other side, I'm not going to go over that, but we'll see. This is what happens in Daniel chapter 9, verses 24 through 27. So you'll have all on one page, front and back, everything you need to know to get in a conversation with somebody about end times. Because let me tell you, friend, if you're in the culture at all, and you're doing anything right that God would have you to do, there are going to be people that are going to come up to you and say, hey, what makes you different than everybody else? And you say this, it's because I know the king. And this is what the king says. You can photocopy that off. There's no copyright things. You can photocopy out. You say, man, I want to change that. Go ahead, make your own. This is just my feeble attempt to kind of make sense of my own mind. So you can use that, photocopy that off, and give it. Say, hey, take God's word and study it. Look at it. See if it makes sense.